Good evening and welcome to Democracy in America, a collaboration between Public Humanities at Yale and the New Haven Free Public Library. Matthew Jacobson, Yale Professor of American Studies and History, will be talking tonight with Professor Daphne A. Brooks. Dr. Brooks is a professor of African American Studies, American Studies, Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies, and Music at Yale University. Her brand new book is Liner Notes for the Revolution, The Intellectual Life of Black Feminist Sound. And from what I understand, it came out today. This is a work that underscores this culture's undervaluing of intellectual discourse or serious analysis of Black women's musicians and the lack of recognition of Black women's arts journalism and music criticism. We have a copy of the book here at the New Haven Free Public Library, and I encourage any librarians that may be listening to get a copy for your patrons. I think it would be a great addition to your music book collections. Please welcome Dr. Daphne A. Brooks, and of course, great to see you again, Matt.
Always great to see you. Thank you so much, Marianne. Welcome everybody, it's great to see you. We look forward to the day when we're back in a brick and mortar world and we can be in the same room together. But until then, we do what we can. Thanks to our partners at the New Haven Free Public Library. This is a partnership that really means a lot to us. We look forward to continuing it. Thanks also to my colleague, Karen Rothman, who's done so much for this series, and our associate Swagato Chakravorty, who is working even now on the back end of this webinar. Thank you both. One program note, next week, a week from tonight, Dave Roediger, really the noted, or among the most noted historians of whiteness in particular and race in general in US political culture, the author of Wages of Whiteness, Colored White, and many other books will be joining us for a discussion on race and American democracy. That's next Tuesday. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Daphne Brooks. Daphne Brooks took her PhD at UCLA, and she taught at UC San Diego and Princeton before joining the faculty at Yale, where, as Marianne said, she teaches in four different departments. That's one short of a royal flush. She is the author of Bodies in Dissent, Spectacular Performances of Race and Freedom, 1850 to 1910, Jeff Buckley's Grace, and as of today, Liner Notes for the Revolution, the Intellectual Life of Black Feminist Sound. Full disclosure, Daphne Brooks and I are married, which is neither here nor there tonight. It's not that important. We're just two cultural historians talking. But we're two cultural historians who talk every day. And in fact, two cultural historians who haven't left this house in over a year now of quarantine. I will also add that we met at a public humanities event at the New Haven Free Public Library. That is a little known fact for your Daphne Brooks trivia. So Dr. Brooks, here we are again. Welcome, it's great to have you here.
Dr. Jacobson, thanks so much for having me. I also want to thank Karen and Sogato. I want to thank Marian Higgins and the New Haven Free Public Library staff and the publics who reside in that wonderful institution. Thanks for holding space for us. I appreciate it. So I think when we were talking about what to discuss tonight, I said, what are we going to discuss? I don't know what to discuss. And then we decided maybe it was a good idea for me to share a little bit of an overview of how to think about the historical contours of this project. And that's something I've been doing of late in a few different contexts. And so I will do that now. I will do that now. Right quick, and then you should ask me anything you like. Nothing's off limits. So, you know, one of the things that I like to say when I describe, when people ask me, what is this book about? I like to respond with a question. if you were to point to a moment that marks the advent, before I start that, let me cue this up. That's our dog who just passed away. I think people know that. Farrah Griffin and Gail Wald, I want to flag, who are two key interlocutors to this project today. Is Farrah's birthday, and some of their works that made it possible for me to do my work, and other Black feminist scholars, including our own Hazel Carby, whose work is cited here. But let me go here, right? Mm-hmm. If I can, actually, yeah. So if you were to point to a point that marks the advent, the beginning of contemporary popular music culture, where would it be is the question that I like to pose to people. Old schoolers, as I've pointed out, would probably suggest here at this moment in which Elvis swivels his hips and revolutionizes the world, or here to the guitar slinging era of classic blues in the late 1920s. We have revisionist historians, some aforementioned, such as Angela Davis and Hazel Carby and Daphne Duvall Harrison, who would take us back, rightly so, to the scene of the early classic women's blues era in the early 1920s. And then you have scholars like Eric Lott and others who would remind us of the importance of blackface minstrelsy as being deeply foundational to popular music culture. But the question that has been guiding me with this book project that I've been working on for quite a long time is, what happens if we tell the story of popular music culture as we come to know and to feel and to experience it today by instead starting with the catastrophe of 1619? And so by that, of course, I'm thinking about how the Atlantic world slave trade becomes foundational to how we understand musical performance, expressiveness, sonic cultures in North America, as having been shaped by a dispossessed class of peoples and their relationship to power, and vice versa. So what happens if we tell the story of popular music culture through that lens? And even more still, what if we were to center the ideas and the feelings and the observations and the desires of Black women, the sisters who were the descendants of those people who were held in the hold of a ship, who worked the fields, who were confined to the kitchen? What if we actively kept that history front and center in our readings of musicians, Mamie Smith, pioneering blues musician, Ethel Waters, blues vaudevillian, cinema star, virtuosic vocalist across many genres, Zora Neale Hurston, who many folks are not aware of, actually took to the field with a recorder, traveled the global South and recorded the sounds of her people. Zora is again. Esther May Scott, little known blues traveler who moved from doing domestic work fluidly between doing domestic work out into juke joints, playing the blues after hours from her time on the clock during the day. Her more contemporary to so many of our publics, Janelle Monáe, and her Afrofuturist repertoire of the 21st century. What if we thought about her music in relation to that long history of violence that we can mark from 1619 forward, but of course has an even longer temporality to it? This is Renee Marie. She's one of the vocalists who I focus on in this book. Who engages in a kind of transformative performances of rearrangement, interpolating the Star Spangled Banner with Lift Every Voice and Sing. I think this musician needs no introduction. nor does this one, right? So Black women's musicianship across the centuries, if we could think about that musicking, that generations of musicking as taking into account the socioeconomic, material, and psychic conditions that undergird Black women's artistry, if we could do that, if we could hold all that together, how would that maybe change the ways that we talked about popular music culture altogether? How would that affect the nature of what we valued about the music? How we narrated its worth, how we interpreted the work of the music itself as an archive of historical memory, an archive of our affective relationship with historical memory, and a multifaceted mode of both social critique and social intimacies. Could we think of the music as holding all of that together? The thing that I was ultimately after, and I'll stop speaking in just a moment, was something that was shaped by centuries of violence, by systemic inequities, by the enormity of chronic loss and marginalization. And I wanted to think about how we could write through that as scholars of not just popular music culture, but Black studies, and think about the fundamental entanglements between the two, right? The last thing I'll say, I was also determined to tell a story that was not just about all the young dudes, I'm not gonna play this song right now, that have been carrying the news and dominating the knowledge production about Black music, right? Many of whom I call my friends and my mentors, right? But I wanted to be able to bring to the fore the story of Black feminist thinkers and creatives who are producing their own knowledge about Black women's art and music. So that was Lauren Hansberry, we just saw, Zora Neale Hurston, the great jazz legend, Mary Lou Williams, the great bebop experimentalist jazz legend, Abby Lincoln, as well as some of our more contemporary music critics, Lorraine O'Grady, who just had a big profile in the New York Times this past week and known as one of the godmothers of Black feminist performance art, had a history before that writing for Rolling Stone magazine. You know, what did she bring to the ways that she wrote about popular music culture? And Phil Garland, who was the principal music writer for Ebony magazine and wrote tracks of prodigious meditations on the soul music tradition. Right? Cynthia Dagnall Myron wrote for the Chicago dailies about rock and roll. I also wanted to think about all the fans who make meaning out of the music they love and value. So that includes my 94-year-old mother, who at 90 gave me many stories in an oral history that I wrote about her and conducted with her, about her time in the Texas record stores, Jim Crow culture, as well as Marsha Music, local legend in Detroit. Right. I keep going here. I promise I'll stop. The blues historian Rosetta Wrights, who started her own independent record label. We can talk about her later, and wrote these incredible liner notes for the music she recuperated. And the first rock critic for the New Yorker magazine, Alan Willis, right? So I was trying to get my arms around a bigger story of popular music culture than the one that has appeared historically in a variety of different academic scholarly works, but also in the popular press for generations now. I wanted to shine a light on the different communities who create their own knowledge about the music that they care for. So that's my short little overview about this book, but what should we talk about today?
Well, thank you so much. I think there are many august scholars on this call, but there are many folks too who might not be used to thinking about popular culture as an important site for the mm-hmm. politics of Black liberation or Black feminism. Can you talk a little bit about how you came to this line of inquiry? You started out writing about the 19th century and theater, And now you've worked your way through the 20th and up to the 21st century in popular music culture. Can you just talk a bit about how your ideas have developed about that intersection of the liberation project and cultural production and culture itself?
Sure. I mean, you know, the simplest answer to your question is that culture has historically been, in my opinion, the most fundamental thing, a dispossessed, a marginalized, a disenfranchised and dehumanized peoples could rely upon as a form of self-making, world-making, as a means to communal articulations of social and political ambitions and desires, as equipment for living, as Ralph Ellison would put it, as collective modes of planning and strategizing, means of survival in the face of tyranny, right? It's we could call it expressive dream work. The great Sadia Hartman might put it that way. And it has the ability to both operate as the improvisational site for, I like to think of it as rehearsals for and experimentations of other ways of being, as many of my colleagues in performance studies might refer to it as well. Culture can serve as a platform to reject and to revise the dominant scripts, right, that have historically and systemically and brutally defined people who had no other recourse, right, to set the record straight, so to speak, right, about themselves. So culture is also the place where marginalized peoples, and I'm obsessed with this point, could go about the business of documenting their experiences, engage in modes of memory work when they had no material, no fiscal, no social access to building institutions of their own, as I like to say to my students, libraries, archives, museums, that could take stock of their past, memorialize it, could be a site for studying and absorbing it, and absorbing the past and laying claim to it. I also think maybe you want me to talk about that bridge between the first book and the second book a little bit, right?
Sure, yeah.
Which people ask me about. And there is really kind of a conscious fluidity between the last chapter of Bodies of Dissent, in part focuses on the postbellum polymath, Pauline Hopkins, who was a Black nationalist journalist, former vocalist, sentimental novelist, anti-lynching activist. She appears in Bodies in Dissent. And then I really initially, she was right at the very beginning of this book. And now she's in chapter one. So she's close to the beginning. And I wanted her to be I wanted this history to kind of turn on the hinge of what her aspirations with regards to culture writing and knowledge production about Black women's culture at the dawn of the modern century, as it's sometimes called, what that could represent for thinking about this kind of long, unheralded, you know, history of, you know, intellectual life and world making on the part of Black women thinkers and creatives. So she's the hinge figure, right? And I guess between the first book and the second book, I'm interested in these kind of the ways that renegade Black performers go about disrupting and defamiliarizing the performance tactics of Black performers and activists, they go about disrupting and defamiliarizing their own performance tactics and presumptions about how Black people are supposed to appear and presumed to appear in the Atlantic world from the antebellum period to the 20th century. What I wanted to do in this book is to think about how Black folks, even as they're performing, had to create their own kinds of critical apparatuses to define the value, right? And to identify the value in the work that they were doing, right? Because we know that the history of knowledge production in American culture is anti-democratic. It has to be. It has to be in order to, create these kinds of, modes of hegemonic representation and circumscribing definitions of various categories of people. So I wanted to really kind of take that apart. And that's where I feel the kind of the bridge between the first book and the second book.
One of the pieces that you wrote right at the kind of outset when you were starting to think in this really ambitious way about the sweeping study of the 20th century, you wrote a piece edited by one of the old dudes and a mentor, Creel Marcus.
And Marcus.
It was a piece on Mamie Smith's Lou. Can you talk a little bit about why and how that's such an important moment in the history of popular music?
Yeah, I mean, I can't thank Grill enough for giving me that opportunity. And I mean that. I mean, it was an invitation to really to think about the long history of African Americans in relation to the culture industry, right? And with pressure on the term industry itself. Fair Griffin was also pivotal with regards to that piece as well. They both were like dream editors to me. But the thing about Mamie Smith, and we saw an image of her that, you know, she's the synecdoche for, you know, systems of subjugation within American culture itself, because the fact that she records the first, she makes the first blues record by an African-American would seem to be of little note to those of us in our modern 21st century universe who are, you know, immersed in and situated in a world in which African-American artists and musicians dominate the industry. As performers, still not, you know, in structures of power, right? But those structures of power 100 years ago in 1920 were loath to even imagine two things. One, the legibility of and viability of Black listening publics actually being invested in not only caring about popular music, but being willing being willing to invest in popular music culture by way of, you know, purchasing the records. They didn't believe that black record consumers actually existed. They also didn't believe, or at least the kind of the dominant line was, they didn't believe that African American musicians had the discipline, the vision, or the professionalism to actually make records. And so, you know, in that early, you know, first decade of the recording industry, blues records were made, heavy scare quotes around blues, by white performers who had a kind of adjacency to the culture itself, usually through forms of systemic power, through, you know, having people in the domestic class, Black peoples who would introduce the sounds to them. And so Mamie Smith and Perry Bradford were able to convince a record label to, you know, give them a chance, so to speak, to make this recording Crazy Blues. And it becomes, you know, an absolute phenomenon, not just in African-American communities, it's a national phenomenon, but importantly in African-American communities who bought the record in droves. So she's key to this story, and in being able to tell that story in what was a kind of broad literary history of American culture that I was invited to contribute to that collection. It's a marker of what it means for African-Americans to make interventions in these socioeconomic systems of subjugation that nevertheless exploit their labor. And labor is another key term in the book, right? That I wanted to really put pressure on, not only thinking about performance labor, sonic labor, but also the labor and also the kind of the affective intimacies that are a kind of labor on the part of Black feminist thinkers who were invested in trying to identify the complexity and wonder of that music that others found disposable, are not of high value.
Mm-hmm. Two of the other early blues women that you write about are Geechee Wiley and L.B. Thomas, who are Well, you can tell us how to think about them. I think of them as almost like fugitives in history somehow, but
or fugitives from history, magic. Fugitives
from history. Can you talk a little bit about both their music and also what they kind of how you've learned to read them as figures who have a lot to tell us?
Right. I mean, the other piece of that would be they're also those who have told us what we might want to think about Gishinelvi are part of the story of Gishinelvi. And that was something that was principally so important to me in this book. Again, Grom Marcus and John Jeremiah Sullivan, independent blues music scholar, won a Wyndham Campbell Award a few years back, some years back now, 5 or 6 years ago, which is when I met him in person. But they're connected to the ways in which the story of these two musicians has circulated over the past two decades. They were blues musicians that we now know hail most likely from Texas, one definitely from Texas, L.V. Thomas, the other Gishy Wiley most likely. They recorded just the slim little, body of music for the biggest race records company in the country for a period of time in the 1920s, Paramount Records. When I first got to Yale in 2014, I was really lucky to be able to hold an event in which we marked the reissue of those recordings. From Revenant Records, from a wonderful set of interlocutors, including the musician Jack White, who came and played those records with us. Grail Marcus was there. Grail had been interested in especially one recording, Last Kind Word Blues, made by these two musicians. And some of the things that make them unique is when you think about blues women artists, you often think about the heavyweights. You think about Bessie, you think about Ma Rainey, you think about one sister, just rocking the mic. And these are two women who played duets with each other, spare and really kind of, some would characterize it as gothic or melancholic sort of meditations on a variety of different intimate subjects. They became critical darlings when they were recuperated by some of the critics and record collectors from the 1960s forward, but especially at the turn of the last century into this century. Grail Marcus wrote beautifully about this recording. John Jeremiah Sullivan had been a research assistant to Grail Marcus and picked up the trail, as he has called it, of trying to find out more about where they came from. So we knew very, very, very little about these women, other than the fact that they had made these recordings in early 1930 in Grafton, Wisconsin, of all places, where Paramount Records recording studios were located. So, not in the South, but in the Midwest, right outside of Milwaukee, right? That resulted, John Jeremiah Sullivan's research resulted in his award-winning essay from 2014, New York Times Magazine, front page cover piece about trying to trace who they were. And it was really, really important work. The questions that I wanted to ask, and we can listen to some Gishinelvi and really should at this point, but I will just emphasize that the piece of the story that became really important to me to try and tell in this book was, why is it that we don't know more about them, as opposed to what do we know and not know about them? So to get back to those histories of violence, right? One, if not both of them, were touched by the carceral state. And one, if not both of them, were entangled in forms of domestic violence, which became sites of fugitivity for each of them. And so when I say they're fugitives from history, I'm saying they're fugitives from the kinds of historical protocols of how we write about Black lives and what we have to say about Black women in the archive. Blues historians have had very little to say historically, I would argue, about that history of violence. And so I wanted to tell a story of asking different questions of their archive and trying to find a different set of answers that honors the silences about what we know and don't know about them. And that could maybe, you know, think more about the scratches in their records, who held those records. It turns out my mother, who will always claim I wasn't a blues fan, but an R&B fan, we could talk more about that. But my mother's generation has much to say about the music that they loved as Black girls. And so I wanted to try and write a more capacious history of that moment. But maybe we can listen to some Gishin Elvi. Should we do that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. And I don't know if we have time to play the whole track. There's Bessie to Beyonce. There's Pauline Hopkins. Well, I hope we can, oh, I'm in the right thing. There we go. These are some of the women in the book that we can talk more about. Okay. All right. You can let me know, Matt Jacobson, how much of Gishin Elvi we should listen to. I can listen to them all night.
If I die in the German war, I want to send my body, send it to my mother-in-law. Baggy chill, please don't bear my soul. I can't just leave me out, let up a when you see me coming, look across the Richmond field, and if I don't bring you flowers, I'll bring you both to you.
Maybe that's a place to stop.
I hate to stop it.
So a question has come up in the Q&A, and I want to invite everyone to please submit questions. I of course could keep asking all night, but I want to open the floor to you as well. But here's a question that I think this might be a moment to really think this through with you. The question is there always a link between the Black church and secular Black music? How do you think about the relationship between, you know, what between gospel, what Du Bois called the sorrow songs, what we think of as early blues. How do you think about those relationships and the kind of syncretism between these cultural forms?
Yeah, I mean, we know from Henry Louis Gates's epic PBS narrative about the Black church, right? That the long history of the ways in which spiritual life worlds have mattered to the sustenance of African Americans is crucial to sonic production and musicking, as we call it in sound studies, a kind of capacious way of understanding how music is ubiquitous in our cultural lives, right? And in that sense, religiosity and, you know, articulations of faith are crucial to the ways that we understand the history of the dispossessed and the Black dispossessed in this country. I guess I would say, since Gishi and Elvi, we know again from John Jeremiah Sullivan's Crackerjack research, actually met in one of the country suppers out in Texas, and had a really radical and luminous set of affective relations that we would most likely characterize as queer. And we know We know that L.V. Thomas in particular moved in centrally into the Black church when she moves back to Houston after making those recordings and denounces her blues past. But I guess I want to say that both queerness, of course, exists in Black church publics, but that they also occupied a space outside of some of the protocols and what I want to say, circumscriptions of social life that one finds in Black religious publics, and found the blues to be, from what we do know, from the little archive that we do have of the L.V. Thomas interview, to be a kind of, another sort of site of alterity. So I guess I don't want to, I want to suggest that there are many imbricated worlds in which these musicians made meaning out of their existential selfhood. And some of that crossed over into, organized religion. And some of that crossed over into the radical informalities of blues publics. And, I'm sure there are people on the line who could talk about that formulation of, Saturday night at the juke joint and Sunday morning in the pews. So.
Right. One of the other things that's suggested by the itinerary of Gishi and LV is that trip from Texas to Grafton, Wisconsin, and within the broader context of the Great Migration, not that they were migrants necessarily, but they were taking part in this huge kind of geographical movement. And the industry itself is really interesting to think about in against the backdrop. I mean, it's kind of occasioned by and created by the Great Migration, in that the industry as a culture industry is really a northern urban phenomenon, but the cultural forms that it's circulating are very much kind of out of the South and bear thick traces of this, a South that's never quite fully escaped. Can you talk a little bit about the significance of the Great Migration to the kind of musics that you're looking at in the 20s and 30s?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I think the circularity of migratory Black cultures is manifest in blues cultures, and maybe a way that is potentially distinct from the presumptive linear patterns of the Great Migration. This is something I'm just thinking about right now, so you can help me with this. But the performers were afforded a kind of fluidity between spaces such that they were moving back and forth. For many years, we know Maud Rainey does not record Mamie Smith and then Bessie Smith and a whole cadre of other sisters around her in the studio before Maud Rainey is the queen of tent blues and often called the mother of the blues. But that movement, say Bessie's movement from the north and back south through the Chitlin circuit, suggests ways that we can kind of understand again the archival impulses of these musicians to document these different regional spaces through their performances, right? The movement itself is documented in the sound. Many people have talked about that very beautifully, but also the regionalism is much more heterogeneous and kind of pulled together in the sound itself. But that's true of, Black migrating peoples as well. That's, Black Studies 101. You carry these cultures with you. They become hybrid. And you translate them into new forms, and you become, as Toni Morrison puts it in jazz, new people. But even in that narrative, it's about the ways that the traces, Joe Trace, and she's always so powerful with the names that she gives, the traces, are carrying something with them. So I think that that's an important thing to keep in mind about the migratory politics of the blues and what it pulls together in terms of documenting the heterogeneity of Black peoples across different spaces.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in your opening comment, you touched on the idea of musicians as archivists, which I think is really important. Mm-hmm. Here's a question, another question that I think really is getting at that. Were there Black female folklorists doing work like Ella Lomax or the Seegers in the 1930s, going through small towns, recording Black women's songs?
Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness. Zora Neale Hurston, who worked closely with Alan Lomax. If anything, Alan Lomax was a stan. That's a little term for our Gen Yers on the call, but an obsessive fan of Zora Neale Hurston's. They had a fractious, complicated relationship. Lomax's father, who was, you know, openly and proudly anti-Black and in a variety of different contexts, despite the fact that he, travels with and circulates the performing body of Lead Belly in a variety of different contexts, and being very pointed in how I'm describing that relationship. But Hurston and Lomax and Mary Elizabeth Barnacle are all part of this WPA vision of being able to document folklore cultures. And not enough people know about the fact that Hurston, a polymath as well, many polymaths in this book, was committed to not only collecting, as she called it, as an anthropologist, the sounds of Black publics and Black Southern publics, but being able to perform those songs and record them. The fact that she performed them herself sheds light on the extent to which she imagined herself and strategized these ways of being an archive, a performing mobile archive. So it's one of the stories that I've been obsessed with in this book for many years, and felt deeply invested in telling that story. And I should thank Linda Carpio and Werner Solers, my American Studies scholars, for colleagues for inviting me to do that work on Sonic Zora many years ago.
To trace that out a little bit further through the century to our own moment here in the 21st century, do you mm-hmm. want to talk a little bit about a singer like Cecile McLaurin-Salvant in those terms as also a kind of archivist?
Mm-hmm. Always. I mean, she's extraordinary. She just won the MacArthur Genius Award. She, was one of the distinguished guests at Black Sound in the Archive, our working group that I co-direct and co-founded with my wonderful colleague, Brian Kane. This is someone who can sound like, has the ability to, let's say, evoke the wondrous virtuosic phrasings and song stylist, prodigious aesthetics of everyone from Nancy Wilson to Dinah Washington, but who has used that arsenal of talents to dig up songs that have long been repressed in the American imaginary, that are usually, a lightning rod in terms of what they suggest about racial and gender violence in American culture. I'll play a snippet from one of her performances that gives you a strong example of that. I will say in the book that I spend a lot of time thinking alongside her performance of Jelly Roll Morton's 30-minute deeply profane queer prison epic narrative called Murder Ballad. She sang it at Jazz at Lincoln Center, and you could see people in the audience clutching their pearls. And I think that has been very important to her, right? To be able to cover these songs that people aren't ready to reckon with and that they don't expect to have to reckon with in popular music writ large, but especially in the world of jazz, in which all sorts of elitisms and racial segregatory politics still exist. And many people have discussed that. I'll share with you a little bit of one of her performances that I don't talk about in the book, but that has held my attention as well. And it's from her Tiny Desk performance at NPR back in 2018.
This last one is a very old song. It's called Omi Wise. Let me see. I'll tell you a story of little Omi Wise, how she became deluded by John Lewis's lies. He told her to meet him down by Adam Spring, some money he would bring and some other fun thing. Then foolish like she met him at Adams' spring. No money he brought her, nor other fun thing. No money to flatter the case. We'll go and get married, there'll be no disgrace. John Lewis, please tell me your mind. Do you intend to marry me or leave me behind? Little old me, I'll tell you my mind. My mind is to drown you and leave you behind. Please pity our baby and spare me my life. I'll go home a beggar and won't be your wife. He hugged her, he kissed her, he turned her around. He threw her in deep water where he knew she would drown.
Very hard to stop that, but it gives you a sense of what a risk-taking and daring artist she is. And, you know, her absolute deep-bone commitment to, you know, I would say kind of, you know, vocalizing the ugly, right? And really paying attention to the ways that that violence that I keep speaking of is not only something to document through music, but is constitutive of the way that we have access to popular music and which kinds of popular music gets to hold our attention in the American cultural imaginary. I could talk about her at great length.
Yes, well, you're about to. Here's another great question from the floor. In our class on the Black radical tradition, we talked a lot about Nina Simone's covers and her transformation of songs. I came across Cecile McLaurin-Salvant's cover of Visions this morning, and I was wondering if you could talk about the role of the cover song as part of the intellectual work you're tracking in the book.
Thank you. Who asked that question? Just for...
Irene Vasquez.
Oh, Irene. Brilliant scholar on her way many places. Yeah, cover songs are super important. We did talk about that and in my class, and it's something that I've especially been focused on in a part of the book that ended up getting lopped off, which is kind of wild to think about since this book with footnotes is 598 pages. but I wanted to drive home the idea of Black women as archivists in a final section that's now a standalone book on. And I've talked about this at Yale before, the women who've performed in Porgy and Bess across generations. Porgy and Bess, which has deeply anti-Black roots in South Carolina from its initial architect, Du Bois Hayward, and in conversation with the Gershwins, despite the fact that it gave us some of the most dazzling popular music of the 20th century. Summertime is a song that has been recorded more than any other song in popular music culture, literally. That's in the Guinness Book of World Records, at least the last time I checked. Somebody may check again, but and one of the things that I've been struck by is the number of Black women musicians from Billie Holiday who recorded the first popular version of Summertime, you know, all the way through someone like a diasporic phenom like Angelique Kidjo are able to tell a variety of different tales about Black time, about Black subjugation, about Black labor and exploitation through their recovery of that song in ways that I think would be surprising to people who think of it centrally through the folk opera from which it emerged. So it is an important, thank you, Renee. It's an important heuristic practice to the cover song performance. But also the ability as students of music and students in the Black radical tradition to pay attention to the cover song as being a palimpsest, meaning a layered kind of cultural work that marks time, marks space, marks community, and is a site of struggle in and of itself.
Yeah. Can you say more about, Porgy is so fascinating because it is just flat out a racist text. And yet, as you have written about so many African-American performers, the best character more than any other character, but have figured out ways to make it into a vehicle for a kind of dignity that the text itself does not offer. Can you talk about in formal terms, like how do you understand, like how does a singer do that?
Well, I mean, okay. I mean, and I'm sure our generational people on the call might like recoil a little bit at the word dignity because we think through Evelyn Briggs Higginbottom about the politics of respectability, although that absolutely was a key interventionist move for many of the early Besses who came along. And the figure of Bess is a wayward figure, Pace Hartman. So being able to think through, say, Horton Spiller's theories of what it means to kind of, to claim the monstrosity, right, of the pathologizing ways in which Black womanhood has been defined in American culture is part of what actually sound performance can do, right? It can open up these ways of, being able to capture something affective about that role that goes beyond the disciplining social comportment expected of African-Americans in order to assimilate into the body politic. I would say somebody like Alicia Hall Moran, who was Audra McDonald's understudy and then was in the touring version of the Diane Paulus iteration of Porky and Bess and Susie Laurie Parks, is somebody who really played with the edges, of a kind of surplus and fugitive modes of expression that, and fugitive modes of sound in her Bess that take into account all of the different contradictions of that character. And also the fact that that character was invented by, a Southern racial romanticist who, believed in the unreconstructed South for much of his life. That would be Du Bois Hayward.
Right. Yeah.
Do we have time for one song?
Well, we have time. We have time for one.
Go ahead. Okay. All right. I'm going to close out with something. You're frozen.
Sure. Can you hear me at all?
You there? Yeah, now okay. I can hear you.
Mm-hmm. Here's a question from the great Brittany Livingston. Can you say more about the space between the blues and R&B that you mentioned your mother flagged so specifically? I think of R&B as a creation of the music world to delineate race records of a certain type, but that has its own meanings now and then with Black artists and listeners like your mother.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's from one Texan to another, my mother to Brittany Livingston. So thank you for that question. I did an event last night for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with my colleague Maureen Mann, who has a fabulous new book on African-American women and rock and roll. And she writes in the introduction to that book about, and I'm going to kind of paraphrase it a little bit, another form of systemic control, which is how genres and pop music categories are ways of trying to stabilize certain boundaries, racial boundaries, social boundaries, such that, and you've already pointed this out, Brittany, in the ways that you're describing the kind of evolution from the blues to R&B, but such that the record labels can keep control of which publics are being steered towards which kinds of music. So I think my mother, I should have had her on the call tonight. She's out in California, busy doing other things, but at 94. But I think from my mother's standpoint, she wanted to be able to mark a kind of modernity. She wouldn't put it that way, but with R&B as having something to do with, the very local, many microcosmopolitanism of Little Texarkana, which was an industrialized city that she grew up in, as being distinct from the rural blues. I think that's what she meant by that. And I should say too, when we go back to thinking about the gospel again, of course, that's a hybrid sound that is a manifestation of the Black migration, the Great Migration, right? The ways in which you get a Mahalia Jackson moving from New Orleans to Chicago and being able to play with the spiritual sonic life worlds that were important to her in responding to urban environments. Guthrie Ramsey writes about this very beautifully. So I think that was kind of where my mother was going with R&B. But I guess R&B is also interesting to me because it's, you know, it's often used to sort of racialize and, or let's say mark as linked to Black publics what is truly the origins of rock and roll. So it's really rock and roll music, if we want to, you know, talk about categories. It just happens to be the music that was innovated by, you know, queer icons like Little Richard, who Tavia Nyong'o writes about so beautifully, and Big Mama Thornton, who Maureen Mann writes about so beautifully, right? So this gets back to, again, the kinds of structural narratives, right? Or the narratives emerging out of structures of power that I'm interested in addressing in this book. You're frozen again.
Can you hear me? You're frozen now.
Maybe this is when I can play some more music.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now. Yeah. I know we have 1 minute left.
Yeah, we're almost.
Can I just play something?
Almost out of time, yeah. But I happen to know you can play us off at the end. But let me first ask you this question. I know that this book, as big as it is only the first volume of a trilogy. Tell us where you're going next.
Yeah.
What's happening next?
I'm a little frozen. You're freezing.
Just put on the music.
Right. Yeah, so there's the Porgy and Bess project. Let's rethink the history of Porgy and Bess through the Black women sonic geniuses who anchored that production. And then there are two other volumes to this thing that started with liner notes, which by the way had to start with kind of, you know, the intellectual history of popular music culture and racial power and how to unseat it through Black feminist thinking. So the second book is thinking about the mid 20th century and democracy, questions of citizenship and Afrocosmopolitanism through figures like Nina and Eartha Kitt and Etta James. And then the last volume is about the third Reconstruction through the Knowles sisters and post 68 Black women's popular music culture. So those are the three. Can I play this just a little bit? I played this at our gathering this weekend, but this is just what I want to say.
I'm going to say our goodbyes and then you can play it. I just want to say thank you. Thank you, Daphne Brooks, and congratulations on the book. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Wash your hands, wear a mask, take good care of yourselves, and we will see you next week for Dave Roediger, Tuesday night, March 2nd. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm just playing everybody out with this particular song. It's a weird song to include in relation to the book, but it's been very resonant for me. This is a cover of the Bee Gees, How Deep Is Your Love, by this musician, African-American musician in the power pop band of, whatchamacallit, or what are they called? Maroon 5, right? He does a duet with Alex Isley, who's the niece of Ron Isley and the legendary Isley brothers. And I thought the story about questioning the depth of love, it's just a place to go and thinking about the work that we do as critics and how we care for archives and how we may not care for certain kinds of figures in the archive, right? And I guess I wanted to end on that because I've been thinking a lot about tenderness. I wrote an article about this rock band Radiohead, one of my favorite bands, and about their relationship to Black music. I got a lot of racist hate mail. And I thought at the time, you know, I would love to be able to send back to these people just a clip of Nina Simone covering Otis Redding's Try a Little Tenderness. And so I wonder what it would mean to carry ourselves inside of the academy and outside of the academy by way of an ethics of tenderness in relation to the topics that we deeply care about. That's what I would want to send people off with. Thanks for the conversation.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you guys so much. You know, I'm never going to stop teasing you about meeting in the library and getting married, okay?
I can't believe you told that story.
It's going to be the story that I tell everybody.
Everybody? Yeah, go,
yes,
come,
everybody.
Come find your husband or wife in the library. Yeah.
Well, that was a great story. Look at this. This is beautiful.
Thank
See, the
so
library
much.
Works. Good night, everyone.
Thank you. 'Cause we're